Good afternoon. I'm Stephen Tromans. Welcome to this webinar on COP26, Glasgow and beyond. Delighted you can join us. We have apparently about 153 people registered for this event, so a good number of you. I'm joined by the people you can see on the screen who are going to be presenting the sessions in this webinar. In order of appearance, we have Catherine Dobson, followed by Richard Wald, Ruth Keating, Gethin Thomas, and Stephanie David. And we'll follow that with some questions. But I'm going to begin by saying a few words, just for a couple of minutes, about COP26 to set the scene. So COP26 has come and gone, ending, as we know, on a somewhat downbeat note. I think we have a slide showing the chair looking a bit downbeat at the end of it. After 2 weeks and 40,000 or thereabouts participants, as I understand it. It's, of course, easy to be cynical about the event, but it's also important to recognise the positives and the scope to build on those positives. The eventual outcome, the Glasgow Climate Pact, was never going to be greeted with the same elation as the 194 nation Paris Agreement after COP21 in 2015. That was what some people have called an exercise in creative ambiguity, leaving it with nations to come forward with their nationally determined contributions, which, as we know, fell very far short of what is needed for the Paris goal of limiting warming to 1.5 degrees C. Instead of that grand design approach, the Glasgow COP26 took the approach of a series of more practical agreements on subjects such as methane, coal, deforestation, finance, and so on. These aren't the headline-grabbing big deal which the public and the media might have been looking for, but in practical terms, they will have a significant combined effect, I believe, and they do leave the door well open to further developments. The aspect of the Glasgow Pact which attracted probably most adverse attention was the decision on coal and fossil fuels, weakened, as we know, by late objections from China and India, so as to refer to accelerating efforts towards phasing down rather than phasing out unabated coal power and to ending inefficient fossil fuel subsidies, though with no timeline. We do, of course, have to see that against the background of a world in which billions of people in particularly developing countries remain entirely dependent on coal for their energy needs. So phasing out coal is a very, very, very big ask, which may explain why we have ended up where we are. Other disappointments were the rejection of the proposed fund to help pay for loss and damage to the most affected nations. We're going to have a session with Stephanie on loss and damage later, rejected by the US, by Europe and Australia. And also the failure to have met the 2020 target of providing $100 billion a year to assist developing countries cut their emissions. We knew, of course, well before COP26 that we were way below what was required on that. However, on the positive side, for example, the rules for tradable emissions reduction units have finally been settled as part of a lot of tidying up of the so-called Paris rulebook. Stephanie's going to be talking about that as well. That had an immediate effect in leading to a jump in carbon prices on the EU market. And there is, of course, an expectation on countries to improve on their efforts when they come together again in Egypt for the next COP in 2022. So where does that leave us? Where do we go from here? Well, we can look at it globally and we can look at it in UK terms, I think. First of all, globally, I think two big nations, China and the US, China does appear to be taking decarbonisation more seriously with its 2060 carbon neutrality pledge. And this is a very big but, the question is whether it can in fact deploy the trillions of dollars which will be needed over the decades to bring about a very radical transformation of its economy, which accounts for 30% of greenhouse gas emissions globally and still has fossil fuels comprising 85% of the energy mix. In the US, the Biden administration, as we know, is seeking to promote important climate legislation in Congress as part of its Build Back Better package, with provision for over $550 billion on tackling climate change. But that, of course, is no straightforward task politically. There is little or nothing that any of us in the UK can do to affect these massive global developments. We're essentially spectators. However, as UK lawyers, we do have roles in how the UK's own international commitments and government policies and ambitions play out, and that will be the essential focus of this afternoon's seminar. If we could just move on to the slide which shows the programme. So that's what we're going to, cover this afternoon. As usual, we very much welcome questions or indeed comments, which you can make using the chat function on your Zoom app. I'm not going to introduce the speakers. They're all members of 1306 Chambers. And if you've watched previous webinars we've done, for instance, on the Environment Bill, you will recognise them from that. Everyone's CV and professional details are on our website, so I won't take up any time now going through them. I'll hand over in a moment to the first speaker, who will be Catherine, and then each speaker will simply follow on in turn. I very much hope you'll find the presentations both informative and enjoyable, and I'll be back at the end to wrap up and deal with questions. So on that basis, it's over to Catherine for our first session.
Thank you, Stephen, and good afternoon. I'm going to talk about net zero and the Climate Change Act. When the Climate Change Act was introduced, it was lauded as a world-leading piece of environmental legislation. It was the first legislation to provide a legal framework for achieving climate change targets, and it's since provided a model for climate change legislation in other jurisdictions. It performs an important role in the UK because it makes the UK's international climate change commitments binding in domestic law. It was only as a result of an amendment to the Act in 2019 that the UK's commitments to achieve net zero by 2050 have any domestic legal force. And as we've seen from the discussions which took place at COP26 over the last couple of weeks, it's vital that the UK and other countries fulfil their net zero commitments if there's to be any hope of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius compared to pre-industrial levels. Given the importance of the UK's net zero commitment, we should consider how effective the Climate Change Act framework is at ensuring the UK fulfills this obligation. So in this first section, Richard Wald QC and I are going to explore the extent to which the Climate Change Act has proved fit for purpose, with a particular focus on the adequacy of the obligation on the Secretary of State under Section 1 to ensure that the UK achieves net zero by 2050, and the linked obligation under Section 4 to stay within carbon budgets. So I'll begin by setting out the key obligations on the Secretary of State under the Act, and then Richard will look at the court's response to climate change challenges in the UK and other jurisdictions. I'll then conclude by suggesting some ways in which the Climate Change Act could be improved, also looking at examples from other jurisdictions. So there are two statutory duties at the heart of the Climate Change Act. First, Section 1 contains a statutory obligation on the Secretary of State to ensure that the UK carbon account for the year 2050 is at least 100% lower than the 1990 baseline. Secondly, Section 4 imposes a two-part duty on the Secretary of State. First, to set five-yearly carbon budgets, which are calculated to put the UK on the path to the 2050 target. And second, to ensure that the net UK carbon account does not exceed the carbon budget for each budgetary period. Now, at the time of its enactment, there was much debate about whether the obligations in Sections 1 and 4 of the Act would be enforceable by way of judicial review. For example, during a debate on a proposed amendment to include sanctions against ministers responsible for carbon budget excesses, the then Minister of State for the Environment stated that a failure to meet the targets under Section 1 and 4 would be amenable to judicial review. the government's consultation document on the draft climate bill was also clear that a government which failed to meet its targets or to stay within budget would be open to judicial review. And there are numerous other examples to similar effect, statements made by members of the government of the day. Now, despite these clear statements as to the government's intent, reservations were expressed at the time about the legal enforceability of obligations under sections 1 and 4. The Joint Committee on the Draft Climate Change Bill concluded that the provisions needed to be altered or strengthened to make them legally enforceable through court intervention. In reaching this conclusion, they drew on evidence given by a number of esteemed lawyers, including Professor Christopher Forsyth, who expressed the view that in the absence of precise sanctions, the duty to achieve the Section 1 target was insufficiently detailed to be enforceable by the court. Similar doubts were expressed by a number of other lawyers who gave evidence to the committee, including Michael Woods, a former UKLA council member, who was concerned that even if judicial review were available in principle, it would not be particularly useful in practice, as it could achieve little more without express sanctions than requiring the government to think again or try harder. So the question is, today, looking at the final text of those provisions, are they enforceable as a matter of statutory construction? And in my view, the language of the provisions supports the argument that they are legally enforceable by way of judicial review. However, I think there are real practical reasons why judicial review may be a difficult tool to enforce compliance with these obligations. I'm going to briefly outline my thinking on those two points. So, first of all, looking at the statutory language, there are two points which, in my view, support the argument that the obligations under sections 1 and 4 are enforceable. First, the Secretary of State is required under both provisions to ensure that the carbon reduction required to achieve net zero is met by 2050 and the carbon budgets are met. Now, ensure is the language of obligation. Added to that, the obligation is to achieve clear and specific results, staying within carbon budgets for section 4 and achieving the net zero target for section 1. And in these respects, sections 1 and 4 can be contrasted with other climate change provisions, which do not impose mandatory obligations to achieve particular results. So, for example, section 10 of the Planning Act, the provision which was an issue in the Heathrow litigation, that provides that in exercising his functions under relevant provisions of the Planning Act, the Secretary of State must have regard to the desirability of mitigating adapting to climate change. Another example, taken from Scotland's Climate Change Act, section 44, places a duty on public bodies in exercising their functions to act in a way best calculated to contribute to the delivery of targets set under the Act. So in my view, the statutory language of sections 1 and 4 supports the conclusion that those obligations are sufficiently clear to be enforced in the courts by way of judicial review. Secondly, the obligations under sections 1 and 4 are unqualified. And in this respect, sections 1 and 4 may be contrasted with other target setting duties where the obligation to achieve a target is qualified by the language of reasonable steps or best endeavours. And I've put two examples on the slides to contrast with sections 1 and 4. One of them is no longer in force, but the point remains. If Parliament had wanted to soften the obligation, it could have done so. And I mention this because some commentators have suggested that target setting duties are by their nature duties of best endeavours, even if they do not contain express language of best endeavours or reasonable steps. This was the view expressed by Professor Forsyth in his evidence to the committee. It's also been a view expressed in contexts outside of the climate change field. I've given an example there of a paper by Catherine Callahan to that effect. My view is that the better view is that set out in De Smith, that if Parliament wanted to qualify an obligation to achieve a target in this way, it would use express language to do so. So for me, that approach aligns with ordinary principles of statutory construction and supports the conclusion that these duties and were intended by Parliament to be legally enforceable by way of judicial review. However, I think there are a number of structural reasons why these obligations will be difficult to enforce through judicial review in practice. The first difficulty is that they're obligations on a single minister to achieve a long-term target or long-term targets. So if judicial review is sought before the target or budget date has passed, the action might be regarded as premature. And if it's brought afterwards, it might be seen as purely academic, since a court order might be said to add nothing to the Act's reporting obligations. So the only way, following that logic, that a challenge could be made prior to the deadline is by identifying decisions or policies which are necessarily inconsistent with the achievement of that target. And that's something that is difficult to do in the context of carbon emissions. The long-term nature of the targets also makes political accountability difficult. Ministers in office at the time when the action necessary to ensure achievement of carbon budgets or the net zero target will not be around if and when the target is not met. The second and linked difficulty is that both obligations are placed on the Secretary of State alone. Without a duty on other government departments or public authorities, there's arguably nothing which legally stops other departments and authorities from acting in a way which is inconsistent with the achievement of targets and budgets. And that was a problem identified by Professor Lord Norton during the passage of the Bill through Parliament. The third difficulty is that the Act does not set out any sanctions for failing to meet the target or budgets. The Act does set out the consequences of failing to meet the target or budgets. So where there's a failure to meet the Section 1 target, the Secretary of State must provide a statement to Parliament explaining why it's not been met. And similarly, in respect of the Section 4 obligation, if a budget has been exceeded, the Secretary of State must explain why that is the case in a statement to Parliament and produce a report setting out proposals and policies to compensate in future periods for the excess emissions. Not only does the absence of any specified sanction make it more difficult for the court to enforce a duty in practice, it also potentially supports the argument that Parliament did not intend there to be sanctions, in court at least, resulting from a failure to achieve the target. So in summary, there's real uncertainty about whether the obligations under Sections 1 and 4 are enforceable in the courts. I think textual analysis pulls towards their enforceability, but there was no consensus on that point during the passage of the bill through Parliament. So I'm now going to hand over to Richard to see how the courts have responded to these sorts of issues.
Thank you very much, Catherine, and good afternoon. So my task over the next 15 minutes or so is to have a look with you what the courts have done. Mostly in recent years. The first two cases are about a decade old. And you'll notice immediately, these are a selection of cases. They're not all the cases that have considered net zero issues. And I'll only be addressing you on those issues that are relevant to net zero. So where other issues are raised and determined, I won't be spending time on that. But the first thing to notice, I think, is that almost all of them, in fact, all of them are NGOs against, with one exception, the Secretary of State. There are only really seven cases there because three and five are the same case in the Court of Appeal and the House of Lords. So I'll do my best not to spoil the suspense by indicating or communicating how the courts have fared set against the test and the hypothesis that Catherine has offered us in her presentation. So the first of these cases, Friends of the Earth and Secretary of State for Business Enterprise and Regulatory Reform, that case is an example actually of Section 2 of the Warm Homes and Energy Conservation Act, which Catherine described as a qualified target. It was Friends of the Earth that appealed the decision of Mr. Justice McComb, refusing its judicial review of an alleged failure to implement its fuel poverty strategy. Under Section 2 of that Act, the Secretary of State had to publish a strategy specifying a target date by which, as far as reasonably practicable, people would not live in poverty. So that's the source of what Catherine describes as the qualified target. There is, on the face of it, plenty of wiggle room there. There was an increase in fuel prices, which rendered the target date likely to be missed. And Friends of the Earth, essentially, for the purposes of today, at least, raised two key issues. Was the Secretary of State required to achieve a particular result by the target date or not? And what meaning is to be given to that phrase as far as reasonably practicable? And in argument, the Friends of the Earth relied on numerous other instances of the use of that very common phrase to suggest that there was more than a merely qualified target, that this was a hard-edged commitment on the part of the Secretary of State. Well, perhaps unsurprisingly, particularly having heard what Catherine said earlier, the obligation was only to make an effort and not to achieve a particular result. I'm paraphrasing there. Current resources were a relevant consideration and there was no applicable minimum standard. So the Secretary of State had not therefore erred in assessing reasonable practicability, in part by reference to departmental budgets. That was permissible. And so we see here an early example of the courts, here the Court of Appeal, in its specific interpretation of reasonably practicable, imposing only a very limited governmental obligation on the Secretary of State to make endeavours, but not to achieve any particular result. I thought it telling at paragraph 2 of the judgment that Lord Justice Maurice Kaye said this: "This style of legislation is of recent origin. Historically, central government has announced and developed its policies primarily through political rather than statutory or legal channels, and the consequences of failure have been political rather than justiciable." So one might detect there some unease, perhaps, at entering into a realm that traditionally, or historically at least, was for politics rather than the courts. So the next case, also dated 2009, is People and Planet against the Treasury. People and Planet judicially reviewed the Treasury's handling of its investments in the Royal Bank of Scotland. The government at the time of this case owned as much as 70% of the Royal Bank of Scotland's share capital. And in accordance with the Green Book and its objectives of preserving the stability of the UK financial system with minimum taxpayer cost, it pursued a purely commercial approach. Now, People and Planet contended that that was an error of law. And the question that came before the court was whether climate change and human rights impacts or harms were relevant to consideration, a relevant consideration, or would they breach Section 172 of the Companies Act? And the duty that brought for shareholders. It's worth noting, perhaps, that within that section is Section 172(1)(d). The section relates the duty to promote the success of the company, and 172(1)(d) is a specific duty to have regard to the impact of the company's operations on the community and the environment. So that was the subparagraph that was in play in this case. Mr. Justice Sales, as he then was, we'll be hearing a bit more from him in a more recent case in his more recent incarnation in the Supreme Court. But then Mr. Justice Sale refused permission. This was just a permission hearing, but one in respect of which there was a reasoned and relatively lengthy judgment. The Greenbelt gave the Treasury a wide discretion as to which factors to take into consideration and as to how it should inform itself. Where the government was a majority shareholder, such as in this case, the Treasury was entitled to adopt a commercial approach to preserve financial stability at minimum taxpayer cost, which were weighty considerations, Mr. Justice Sales found. And the Treasury was entitled to leave addressing such harms to bank regulation. So really, once again, not a matter for the courts, and not an instance of an error of law on the part of the Treasury or the government. In fact, the language used was relatively strong. The Treasury was perfectly entitled to form the view that that was a large topic not suitable to be resolved in the context of this assessment. I think that that reflects an emerging reluctance for judicial intervention in this area. And we'll see whether that is right. We have, as our next example of a net zero case, Plan B in the Court of Appeal. This was an appeal against the Divisional Court's refusal of a judicial review for the Secretary of State's aviation NPS, which designated a third runway at Heathrow as the preferred option for meeting Southeast airport capacity need under Section 5.1 of the Planning Act of 2008. Now, it was common ground in this case that the designation had been done without regard to the government's commitments under the Paris Agreement. In fact, it went a little further than that. The Court of Appeal observed that the advice given was that it ought not to have regard to the Paris Agreement, so it's stronger even than that. The Court of Appeal considered a number of issues, including UK climate change commitments and the appropriate relief. And all of these the climate relief ground centered around the interpretation and application of Section 5A of the Planning Act, which provides that the reasons for an NPS must in particular include an explanation of how the policy set out in the statement takes account of government policy relating to the mitigation of and adaptation of climate change. Well, what did the Court of Appeal conclude? That the climate change ground should prevail, and that was the only one that did. The government's commitment to the Paris Agreement constituted government policy on climate change, which according to 5.8 of the 2008 Act, the Secretary of State had to take into account in his designation decision, and his failure to do so vitiated the designation of the ANPS. In fact, moreover, the Paris Agreement was so obviously material to that designation that it was irrational not to have taken it into account. So quite a strong finding there from the Court of Appeal, adopting a broad and inclusive interpretation of government policy and offering us a first example of net zero arguments prevailing in the UK courts. I know from my own experience of aviation related inquiries that followed, that this was much relied upon by those seeking to oppose major infrastructure development in the months that followed. Well, before we pick up the thread of Plan B in the Supreme Court, we look at an intervening case, Packham and the Secretary of State for Transport relating to HS2. Mr. Packham sought a judicial review of the government's decision to continue HS2 and also an interim injunction to protect six ancient woodlands. This was 9 years after there had been extensive HS2 public consultation. Well, there had been a review, the Oakerview review, exploring the cost-benefit analysis of HS2. And in February of 2020, that review recommended that HS2 should proceed, and the Secretary of State so decided. It's not directly relevant to the net zero issues, but I think it's worth noting, if only as a cautionary tale, that Mr. Packham filed his claim 6.5 weeks later, albeit that this is a claim brought under one of the planning acts. No party raised promptness issues, but the divisional court nonetheless raised it of its own volition, questioning whether the claim had been brought out of time. Did the decision fail to consider climate change issues, and should an interim injunction be granted? So the divisional court dismissed as not prompt because outside the 6-week time limit, despite no other party having raised it. There was no failure to consider climate change issues. The Oakerview review had effectively done so. And the judgment distinguishes the circumstances of the Heathrow case in the Court of Appeal from this one, and then moved on to refuse an interim injunction. As I suggest, I think this is a cautionary tale about the non-extendability of the six-week deadline. And also, it was relevant that this was a project authorised by an Act of Parliament, which featured in the decision on the interim injunction also. So we now pick up the Heathrow thread in the Supreme Court. The Heathrow Airport Limited appealed that decision, albeit that the Secretary of State did not. The government, as will now be clear, had accepted the case for Heathrow expansion in 2015 and has designated the ANPS in June 2018 under Section 5.1. The Court of Appeal, as we just saw, had declared the ANPS unlawful for failure to take account of the Paris Agreement and two ministerial statements made pre-ratification of that agreement. And the Secretary of State, as I say, did not appeal, but Heathrow did do so. So the key issue for present purposes is had the duty under 5.8 to explain how government policy had been taken into account in designating an NPS being breached. So in essence, the answer that the Supreme Court gave was no. The purpose, they looked closely at the relevant parts of the 2008 Act. The purpose of 5.8, the Supreme Court held, is to ensure coherence between NPSs and established government climate change policy. The Court of Appeal had itself erred in ruling that government policy were ordinary words and that the two ministerial statements made before ratification qualified as government policy. Instead, the phrase was to be given a narrow interpretation within its context. And if one didn't adopt such an approach, civil servants would forever be trawling through Hansard or the press to find instances of policy. So the ANPS designated that finally, the ANPS had designated no carbon target. There had been no carbon target specified at that time and no established domestic policy on climate change. So there's very clearly a very marked change from the judgment of the Court of Appeal here, principally based upon a much narrower and context specific interpretation of the words government policy. And it may be worth noting that in a judgment of the Supreme Court, Lord Sales again, 7 months later, in relation to policies generally, this was A in the Secretary of State for the Home Department, said this, policies come in many forms and may be more or less detailed and directive depending on what a public authority is seeking to achieve by issuing one. There's often no obligation in public law for an authority to promulgate any policy, and there is no obligation when it does promulgate policy for it to take the form of a detailed and comprehensive statement of the law in a particular area, equivalent to a textbook or the judgment of a court. So again, that was marked in its departure, obviously different context, but the general observations made about policies there are somewhat at odds with the much narrower and limited interpretation given to those words in the Heathrow judgment just 7 months earlier. Just as a perhaps an add-on to as a demonstration perhaps of the strength of feeling around this issue, Mr. Crossland, who advocated successfully in the Court of Appeal but unsuccessfully in the Supreme Court, breached the embargo on the judgment and was fined £5,000 and found to be in contempt of court for so doing. We move on then to our last couple of cases, or two or three cases in this survey. This is Finch and Surrey County Council, not the Secretary of State, but Ms. Finch judicially reviewed the local planning authority's grant of a planning permission for the retention and expansion of an existing oil well and the drilling of four new ones for 25 years. The authority had assessed greenhouse gases due to excavation but not use of any hydrocarbons thereafter. And Ms. Finch's claim related to whether the EIA regulations and their requirement to consider likely significant both direct and indirect effects of a development extended to greenhouse gas emissions of end users. So essentially, was it sufficient to limit oneself in this assessment to the works or activity for which planning permission was sought and granted, or was it necessary, based on that indirect effect requirement, to look further at who would be using the hydrocarbons thereby extracted, and with what emission consequence? So Mr. Justice Holgate held that end user emissions were outside the meaning of effects of the proposed development, and very much limited his interpretation of those words to the ambit of the planning permission, which was sought and granted. There was therefore no legal requirement at all to calculate greenhouse gas emission end user emissions, and there was none in relation to the Paris Agreement allowances either. This is a rather imaginative, albeit unsuccessful, way of bringing the net zero issue before the court by a construction of the requirement to look at direct and indirect effects under the EIA regs. That case is being heard today and tomorrow. So watch this space. We'll know before too long whether that judgment of Mr. Justice Holgate has been upheld. So penultimately, I think, Elliot Smith and the Secretary of State, Miss Elliot Smith, judicially reviewed a decision to create the UK emissions trading scheme to replace the one that we used to be signed up to pre-Brexit, which set a diminishing cap on sector-wide greenhouse gas emissions over a given period and set a reserve price and auction allowances, which could then be traded. The question for the court was, had the cap and auction reserve price taken account of the requirement in Articles 2 and 4.1 of the Paris Agreement to take urgent action in order to limit greenhouse gas emissions? And then secondly, did the UK ETS breach Section 44 of the Climate Change Act by failing to limit or encourage the limitation of activities causing or contributing to those sorts of emissions? Once again, a narrow interpretation and a dismissal of the claim. Mr. Justice Dove held that it was not for this court to resolve questions of construction on an unincorporated international treaty, the Paris Agreement. At most, it could assess whether the Secretary of State's view was tenable, and he held that it was so tenable. The trading scheme did not have to achieve a greenhouse gas reduction to meet the statutory purpose. It was sufficient that it aimed at that, which is rather resonant of the first case that we looked at, where no particular outcome is required, merely in the first Friends of the Earth case, an attempt at a particular outcome. So we come finally to the most recent of our cases, the Transport Action Network Limited and Secretary of State for Transport case. The claimant judicially reviewed the Secretary of State's decision to set a road investment strategy under a 2015 Act, the Infrastructure Act, and Section 3.1 of it. Court had to consider whether the Secretary of State had failed to comply with Section 3.5 by not taking into account the objective in Article 4.1 of the Paris Agreement to reach peak gas emissions as soon as possible and reductions thereafter, which is what Britain and all the other signatories signed up to in Paris. The Paris Agreement was not an obviously material consideration, held Mr. Justice Holgate, relying on the Supreme Court judgment in the Heathrow case, the Friends of the Earth. And so it was not, nor was its urgency objective. And there was no reason to reach a different conclusion in the context of the 2015 Act. So I say, in conclusion of that last case, that application, that broader application of the Secretary of State's judgment in the Friends of the Earth case, albeit that judgment itself was based on a narrow and purposive construction of the relevant legislation. And here we are looking at different legislation. We're looking at a completely different act, but nonetheless, it carried across. And that application, I would suggest, creates a rather daunting task to anyone attempting this argument in the UK without the support of legislative change of some sort. So finally, the upshot of all of this, where are we set against the questions that Catherine posed a few moments ago? Well, the judgment of the Court of Appeal, which is the reason it's there, albeit overturned by the Supreme Court, in Plan B was the high watermark for net zero in the UK courts. And it was a full storm for those hoping to see the predictions expressed in Parliament as to the enforceability of targets and budgets before the enactment of the Climate Change Act. This was Catherine's third slide, where various expressions of optimism were given as to the enforceability or the ability to sanction any breach or even prospective breach of the net zero commitments or Section 1 or 4 or both of them of the Climate Change Act in 2008. So for examples of such enforceability, we have to, I'm afraid, look further afield, and in particular to the Friends of the Irish Environment and Ireland, a relatively recent decision of the Supreme Court in Ireland in which the Irish government's national mitigation plan was struck down for failing to be sufficiently specific as to how climate targets would be met in 2050, and the proposed policies described as excessively vague. So really quite a different approach there adopted in Ireland to the approach that we've seen from judges in our courts here in England and Wales. Also of possible, but perhaps less direct relevance is the Urgenda case. I say less direct because it's worth bearing in mind that international law is directly applicable in the Netherlands, which is one of the reasons why the Dutch Supreme Court were able to interpret their powers under the European Convention of Human Rights boldly and ordered its government to take more dramatic action to counter the threat of climate change. So we can find examples of judicial intervention to contribute to the challenge of combating climate change and the taking governments to task in relation to net zero commitments. But here within the domestic courts, it's difficult to find much excuse for optimism in that regard. And I say that Catherine has a few more slides to present and may be able to provide us with excuses for optimism now.
Thank you, Richard. So in this final section, I don't know if it's excuses for optimism or just bold optimism, because there's no programme for reform of the Climate Change Act, but I've nonetheless gone on to consider how the Act could be strengthened so as to improve the prospects of achieving the 2050 target. And in making the suggestions I've come up with, I've drawn on examples from other jurisdictions, as well as some suggestions that were made at the time that the Climate Change Act was going through Parliament. So first of all, and I think this is a really important one, shorter targets would assist. As I noted earlier, the short-term cycle of government can be one of the biggest obstacles to accountability for achieving long-term targets. The carbon budgets were an attempt to address that, but overall there's a real mismatch between the budgetary timescale of 5 years and the need for immediate action now. So my first suggestion is that the Act would benefit from shorter interim targets to accompany the 5-yearly carbon budgets and the long-term 2050 target. This is the approach that's been adopted in other jurisdictions, and it was in fact the approach that was advocated by Friends of the Earth in their initial campaign, which led to the Climate Change Act. So in Denmark, in the recently introduced Climate Act, that piece of legislation sets a series of reporting obligations on government, including an annual parliamentary examination of the government's action towards meeting climate change targets. And even more robustly in Germany, the Federal Climate Protection Act 2019 requires annual reduction targets to be set for 6 key sectors. My second suggestion is that the Climate Change Act would benefit from express sanctions applicable to government or responsible ministers. As I mentioned, one of the difficulties is there's no sanction on responsible ministers for failing to meet carbon budgets or targets beyond the requirement to provide a report to Parliament giving reasons for the failure. So one of the difficulties and one of the reasons why this wasn't included in the Act that was eventually enacted is the difficulty of identifying an appropriate sanction. during the passage of the bill through Parliament, it was suggested that the Secretary of State might be dragged away to the Tower of London in the event the targets were not achieved. It was also suggested that there could be an automatic reduction in cabinet salaries equivalent to the excess by which the target had been missed. More seriously, one solution that was suggested by the Joint Committee on the draft bill was to suspend the sale of carbon credits and debits by the government during a period default, which has got parallels with the enforcement mechanism, compliance mechanism under the Kyoto Protocol. Another would be to impose a more demanding obligation on government to produce a plan to address any default. So the timeframe could be more pressing than the obligation currently in legislation, which is produce a report as soon as possible. There could be provision made for independent scrutiny of the plan and as to whether or not it will bring about compliance in as short a time as possible. My third suggestion is to extend the duties under the Act to apply to other government actors and public authorities. So one of the problems with the current targets and duties is that are imposed solely on the Secretary of State. And whilst it might be understandable that there's a need to have for a single minister to have overall responsibility for strategy, it would be more effective if duties were linked to the issues which was in the control of each minister. So it could be in the form of a duty on all public bodies. I've set out on the slide there an example from the Scottish climate change legislation, which imposes a duty on all public bodies to act in a way best calculated to contribute to the delivery of climate change targets. Another example is from the German legislation. I already mentioned that that legislation sets annual reduction targets for different sectors. The German legislation goes on to provide that responsibility for achieving compliance with annual emission budgets lies with the ministry responsible for the sector in question. It could even go further and impose obligations on private actors. I wasn't actually aware of the obligation on companies under the Company Act, but that could be a way into strengthening, to imposing, you could strengthen that obligation. For example, in the Netherlands, the Hague District Court in a claim involving Shell held that Shell had to reduce its carbon emissions by 45%. If there was some way to impose obligations on private companies, that might also assist. So, as I said, there's no suggestion that government has any plans to reform the Climate Change Act, and they probably have quite enough on their plate at the moment to be dealing with. But I do think, looking in the slightly longer term, that a few quite modest reforms to the way in which the duties are expressed in the Act could have quite profound consequences and will bring us more into line with our European neighbours and the more recent generation of climate change legislation that we're seeing being enacted across the channel. So I will now hand over to Ruth.
That's great. Thanks, Catherine. Hi, everyone. I'll be presenting on mobilising green and sustainable finance. So looking at the next slide that we have on the screen there, we have the third goal of COP26, and it's focused on finance. So looking at the extracts, and in particular the second part, what it says is that one of the goals is that international financial institutions must play their part, and we need work towards unleashing the trillions in private and public sector finance required to secure global net zero. So financial markets and the impact of net zero on economies is clearly a central focus. And indeed, if one looks then at the notes that were available for COP26 on finance, it reflects this. And what it says at the very outset in reflective finance is to achieve our climate goals, every company, every financial firm, every bank, insurer and investor will need to change. So very definite words there. And looking on to our next slide, if we can move on to the Paris Agreement. This isn't a new requirement that has appeared in COP26. It's something that we see in Article 2 of the Paris Agreement. And indeed, you have the wording there on your screens in front of you. But what that says is that the objective of limiting temperature rises to below 1.5 degrees is perhaps better known but the objective of making finance flow consistent with a pathway towards low greenhouse gas emissions and climate resilient development is also one of the three key objectives in Article 2. So again, something that we see very clearly laid out in the Paris Agreement. But we're seeing this, I think, filtering down finally. And in terms of the requirements that we're seeing from the central bank, and both domestically and at a European level, we're seeing those priorities filtering down. Looking at the statements that we have from the ECB, we can see that on the next slide that you should have in front of you. And we see headline points there. So what it says from the ECB is that it will take the impact of climate change into consideration in its monetary policy framework. And we're seeing similar comments from the Bank of England, and it's saying that it's exploring how climate change impacts its central mission, and that is the bank's mandate for monetary and financial stability. I think that latter comment is interesting because in the desire, of course, to reduce to net zero and to reduce our carbon output, it can sometimes seem like a hugely onerous requirement on firms, when in fact, actually, it really doesn't even make financial sense to continue as some companies have. And so taking a look at the next slide, I'm going to approach this in three ways in terms of mobilising green and sustainable finance. So first, I'm going to look at what's happening in the UK, both in terms of the changes that we've already seen and the changes that we have coming down the line. Second, of course, what's happening in the EU and how that might affect the UK. And finally, what's happening around the world at a global level. So on the next slide, in terms of what's happening in the UK, we of course have the now famous slogan, planet over profit. In terms of the UK, there are quite a lot of policy changes either in place or coming into place in the near future. And the two I'll be briefly outlining are, first, the new mandatory climate-related financial reporting for UK businesses, because that's going to have a huge impact on firms and companies in the coming months. And finally, climate adaptation reports, because they give a sense of how different industries and different financial industries are responding to the new requirements that are going to be placed on them. So looking at the next slide, the new mandatory climate-related financial reporting for UK businesses. In terms of the backdrop for this proposal, it's really become highlighted since the 29th of October this year. BEIS announced that the UK is going to be the first G20 country to enshrine in law mandatory task force on climate-related financial disclosures for large companies and large financial institutions. In terms of the timeline that we're looking at and in terms of the impact, the 6th of April 2022 is going to be the big day for people to mark in their diaries. And what it's going to mean in effect is that many of the largest UK registered companies and financial institutions, and that includes many UK trade companies, banks and insurers, are going to have to disclose climate related financial information on a mandatory basis. There are requirements for what kinds of companies are going to have to report. And in broad terms, they do tend to apply to large companies. So companies with over 500 employees and £500 million turnover. In terms of what the output's going to be, we do have some idea from the draft regulations, which we'll go through. But in essence, companies and LLPs are going to be required to disclose their financial or climate-related information in what's called a non-financial information statement, so an NFIS, in their strategic report. And if there is a company which falls into the ambit of having to report on climate, but they don't currently have to produce an NFIS, they're going to still be required to produce climate-related financial disclosure. So a very strong statement in terms of the kind of companies that are going to be covered. In terms of how we're going to see these changes come in, it's going to be through a variety of means of statutory instruments. There's going to be powers under the Companies Act 2006 that are going to be amended, and of course, powers then equally under the Limited Liability Partnerships Act 2000. If we move on to the next slide, I think this is what gives us probably the best idea of what's going to be required. So we have the wording, or at least the draft wording, which has been laid out, and that's in the Companies Strategic Report, Climate-Related Financial Disclosure Regulations 2021. And the extract that you have on your screens there, that would be an amendment to the Companies Act 2006 that would cover climate-related disclosures. And it goes through the kinds of information that a company will need to provide. So the first that you see there is governance arrangements in relation to managing and assessing climate change related risks and opportunities. And then we go through in the different factors below into the kind of granular detail that's going to be required. So a company is going to have to describe in terms of how it assesses and manages climate related risks. It's going to have to give a description of the kinds of processes it has in place to deal with that. And in particular at four, I think this is interesting, is going to have to provide a description of the principal climate-related risks and opportunities arising in connection with the company's operations and the time periods by which it's assessing it. So that's going to be interesting because, of course, we think of certain companies where climate-related risks are very much at the fore, perhaps insurance, energy companies, but other companies are going to have to turn their minds to those kinds of factors. If we go onto the next screen, then we see the final four factors, and that's that the company is going to have to provide a description of the actual and potential impacts of principal climate-related risks. Again, something that a company may never have had to have done before. And six is interesting, I think, particularly for the insurance industry, because it's going to require an analysis of the resilience of the company's business model and strategy, taking into account different climate-related scenarios. So there's going to have to be some sort of stress testing there. And finally, we see that a company is going to have to provide the targets that it uses in terms of climate-related risks. And finally, the key performance indicators for how it assesses progress by reference to those targets. So very much different relevance for different businesses and companies, but certainly I think something that either some companies are probably already considering and maybe quite worried about, or certain factors there that some companies may never have had to consider before, but will have to on the 6th of April, 2022. If we move on to the next slide then, and in terms of the final point on these draft regulations, it is possible for a company to omit to partake in this disclosure, of course, subject to the conditions that are laid out in the regulations. But if a company or an LLP chooses to do that, they still have to provide what is defined in the regulation as a clear and reasoned explanation for the director's reasonable belief that it doesn't have to provide that information and that it's not necessary. You know, at this stage, all we have are these quite sparse draft regulations, and some of that detail is going to have to be worked out, both in practice and probably in terms of the final draft. But I think it is interesting to look at what is quite a narrow exception there for directors, and taking a step back at this stage as a preliminary view, I think a director would want to exercise real caution before deciding to omit to provide that information, which is clearly going to be provided by the regulations. In terms of the final slide then on the UK and the other methods and interactions and processes that we're seeing coming into place, it's worth mentioning in terms of UK developments that in response to the Climate Change Act 2008, the Financial Conduct Authority, the Prudential Regulation Authority and the Pensions Regulator have all published climate change adaptation reports. If someone has a particular interest in a particular industry, it's certainly worth reading those because they very much give a flavour of where these different regulatory bodies are moving in terms of their focus on climate. Looking at the FCA, it's given the broad overarching statement that it's embedding ESG considerations across everything it does. But what I think is really interesting looking at that report is that the FCA have also said that when firms are designing sustainable financial products, that they can expect the FCA to challenge how well the ESG characteristics of those products align with their sustainability claims. So we're seeing a clear reference from the FCA there in terms of their focus, that they're aware of greenwashing and it's something which they'll be looking into if firms claim that they have green products. In terms of the Prudential Regulation Authority, we of course had in 2019 that it was the first supervisory organisation to issue management of climate-related financial risks and its expectations. In terms of the timeline, it said that in July 2020, it would set a deadline for them to be embedded as far as possible in different firms, and they would expect that to be done by the end of 2021. So certainly those firms are coming to the end of their timeframe for implementing those requirements. And what the PRA has now said that we're coming to the end of that 2021 deadline is that as it moves into 2022, the PRA will actively be supervising to ensure firms meet those expectations. So again, another indication that the clock is running down in terms of time left to comply with these new requirements and these new regulatory standards. And the final point, of course, and it's worth highlighting, is that the pension regulator plans to issue guidance about how we'll look at pension schemes. So again, we're seeing this focus on making sure to protect consumers that long-term investments are sustainable. But we're also seeing a lot more focus on firms to really understand the climate risk of their various products. In terms of the next slide, what we'll see here is what's happening slightly further afield now, and that's what's happening in the EU. So looking at the EU, we're seeing a similar focus. We'll see on the next slide there a summary of the EU changes that we have in place. So in terms of developments, we now have the EU taxonomy regulation, which has, I think, quite a dry sounding name for something which is hugely important, because what it does in effect is it establishes the criteria for determining whether an economic activity is environmentally sustainable. Now, diving into a bit more detail on that regulation, the first point that I would note is that it sets criteria for activities. So it's not setting criteria for companies or other entities, and there is a slight difference there. In terms of whether an activity will be deemed to be environmentally sustainable, the regulation sets four criteria, and they're there on your screen. But in summary, what it has to do is it has to make a substantial contribution to one or more of the environmental objectives contained in the regulation. So clearly what it's focused at there is making sure that you don't have peripheral benefits which don't really come within the spirit of an activity being deemed environmentally sustainable. The second point, of course, is that it can't significantly harm any environmental objectives. And three and four are also important, but perhaps less so, and that's that it needs to be carried out in compliance with minimum social and labour safeguards. They should be well understood by different firms. And finally, that it complies with technical screening criteria. Now, the relevance of all that in practice for finance is quite interesting, because what the EU has also recently proposed is a new Europe regulation for an EU green bond standard. Now, in terms of how that would work, it would be a voluntary standard. But the key difference is that if something is to be an eligible project or an eligible project under the green bond standard, then it would need to comply with the EU taxonomy regulation. And finally, then there would need to be an external review that will be conducted by an entity accredited by the European Security and Market Authority. So again, very much an emphasis on making sure both that changes are made in the industry, but that we're not slipping into the risk of greenwashing, which there could be by certain firms. If we move on to the next slide, then what we see is what's happening around the world. Now, looking around the world, I think we're seeing a similar impact in terms of mobilizing finance, and certainly an indication of where the UK might be heading. So if we go on to the next slide there on your screens, we'll see two main factors to go through. The first is in respect of New Zealand. And what New Zealand has done is it's become the first country to codify aspect of the Financial Stability Board's task force on climate-related financial disclosures. Lots of different countries are, of course, doing that. But what New Zealand has done, which is quite interesting, is it's had a lot of the same disclosure requirements we've seen in other countries and that we are seeing domestically, but it's put real sanctions behind that. So what the bill has done in effect is it's introduced obligations on climate reporting entities, and they're singled out in the bill for their large size and the need to keep proper records. So we see a similarity there with the UK, but the sanctions are very different. So picking some of the headline sanctions that we see in New Zealand now, where there's a failure to prepare a statement and lodge it and include it in the financial entity's annual report, there will be fines. So that, of course, is hugely important. And significantly, both I think for directors and for companies, the bill includes an offence of knowingly failing to comply with climate standards. So a director convicted of such an offence is liable for a term of imprisonment not exceeding 5 years and or a fine not exceeding $500,000. And a financial entity convicted of such an offence is liable to a fine not exceeding $2.5 million. So we see real teeth for the sanctions, which we're already seeing in other countries. And similarly, other countries are highlighted at the end of the slide there. So other major world market economies have new reporting requirements. We see a list there. So France, Japan, Brazil, Hong Kong, Singapore, and Switzerland. So a huge change in terms of culture. Some countries, of course, not going quite as far as New Zealand has at this stage, but it's interesting to see that we already have one jurisdiction imposing quite rigid standards. In terms of the final slide, so where is this going? Looking at all of those policy changes and statutory changes, I think one might feel a little disheartened that some of them might seem either a little bit hypothetical, that they lack some teeth, or that it's difficult to see when some of them might realistically come into play for companies. I think all of that might be true if one didn't have the new reporting requirements, which are going to be brought in, but also some of the interesting case law we've had. So I think it's notable that in the Shell decision, in reaching its decision, the court referred to various reports and brochures, and we've already had Catherine refer to the Shell judgment, but it quoted Shell and it said that Shell had said about its own business model, Shell companies expect to reduce emissions of greenhouse gases in their own operations, as well as helping their customers do the same. And what the court then did was it carried out a forensic analysis of Shell's business model. So it identified that executive remuneration continued to depend on short-term financial targets. The court wasn't happy with that. And it said that less than 10% of the weighting of that remuneration was attached to the energy transition. And they also noted that there was a lack of ambition in its scenario models, which assumed that fossil fuels would continue to contribute 22% of global energy needs, even by the time society reached net zero in 2070. So I think we're seeing a very real way in which this these new regulatory changes could have a very real impact on private litigation and public litigation. In terms of the second bullet point, it's worth highlighting that Client Earth, of course, this week has been arguing a case against the Belgian National Bank. And in essence, what their case is that the Belgian National Bank's purchases of carbon intensive assets issued by some of what it says are the Europe's largest polluters are illegal and in breach of environmental protection. So again, it's interesting. It's particularly interesting because Client Earth are arguing that the ECB hasn't taken into account climate change considerations. And so it's perhaps unsurprising what we saw on the third slide there of comments by the ECB and the Bank of England in terms of how it's adapting to climate change. So all of that is to say, I think increasingly net zero, it's going to result in stranded assets or assets that have been devalued by the race to net zero. And of course, what that means is that if companies fail to adapt, of course, there's going to be a loss of value to shareholders, which opens it up to litigation. And evidently, of course, there's litigation risk and reputational harm if financial institutions fail to react and adapt. And with that, I'll pass on to Gethin, who'll be discussing adaptation.
Thanks very much, Ruth. Good afternoon. So I'll be addressing adaptation. We're all extremely familiar with the trajectory of graphs like these in particular from the Met Office. And as we're all aware, the impacts of climate change are being felt globally. I think it's important when considering the issue of adaptation to bear in mind the scale of the task. In the UK specifically, the Met Office's most recent UK climate change projections suggest that general trends show increased chance of warmer winters, wetter winters and hotter, drier summers, along with an increase in the frequency and intensity of extremes. For example, heat waves like those we had in September 2018, where the needle rose above 35 degrees Celsius, are now 30 times more likely to occur due to climate change. And there's also likely to be future increases in the intensity of heavy rain events, leading to more frequent and severe surface water flooding. The scale of the issue, I think, is very pithily summarized in the COP26 Glasgow Adaptation Imperative that's set out on the slide. Drought, flash flooding, wildfires, and it makes very clear that while no one is immune, it is the poorest countries who are at the front line of climate impacts and the most vulnerable, including young people, women and girls, people with disabilities, and Indigenous people who are hardest hit. Against that setting, the second goal of the four COP26 goals was to adapt to protect communities and natural habitats. And the goal identifies two tasks in particular: to protect and restore ecosystems and to build defences, warning systems and resilient infrastructure and agriculture to avoid loss of homes, livelihoods and lives. But what does adaptation actually mean? Well, the general idea of adaptation, I think, to climate change is as easy to state as perhaps it is hard to achieve. The UN has provided a neat and comprehensive definition set out on the slide. In short, the aim of adaptation to climate change is to safeguard people from higher temperatures, rising seas, fierce storms, unpredictable rainfall, and more acidic oceans. The figure on the right-hand side of the slide is the UN's graphical depiction of the adaptation process. And as you can see, its four stages are stated at a highly broad, vague level of assess, plan, implement, and monitor. The Paris Agreement set a global goal on adaptation under Article 7, which is one of the three core goals established at Paris. Article 7.1 states that parties established the global goal on adaptation of enhancing adaptive capacity, strengthening resilience, and reducing vulnerability to climate change, with a view to contributing to sustainable development and ensuring an adequate adaptation response in the context of the temperature goal. Article 7.10, which is at the bottom of the slide, provides perhaps the most concrete limb of the global goal on adaptation. It obliges each contracting party to submit and then update periodically an adaptation communication, which may include that party's priorities, implementation and support needs, plans and actions, without creating any additional burden for developing countries. The UK in December 2020 published its adaptation communication, and it summarizes how climate adaptation will be integrated across government departments. And I've picked out a few particular points on the slide. It notes the UK impacts, risks and vulnerabilities. The second UK climate change risk assessment was laid before Parliament in January 2017. It included 56 priority risks to the UK, which needed to be addressed in adaptation planning. There's an implementation of adaptation actions and results achieved. Again, it lists a number of recent initiatives, including the National Framework for Water Resources, which was published by the EA. Monitoring and evaluation of adaptation barriers and challenges notes very frankly that the monitoring of adaptation progress remains a significant challenge, with an absence of a full set of robust metrics and indicators, and that adaptation and resilience planning is inherently complex, with uncertainty related to climate models, projections, and what those mean in terms of climate impacts. There's also information as to the implementation and provision of support to developing countries, and reference to the UK's call for action on adaptation and resilience, which was launched in 2019. I've included a couple of pictures of the Thames estuary tidal flooding barrier there. This communication also highlights the Thames Estuary 2100 plan, which sets the strategy for managing tidal flood risk to the end of the century. The UK's adaptation communication also summarises the statutory framework that the UK has in place to plan for adaptation to climate change. So the UK does have a legislative system for programming adaptation efforts and was one of, among the first countries to legislate for climate adaptation. And that is contained in part four of the Climate Change Act. The key provisions are that section 56 places a duty on the Secretary of State to carry out an assessment of the risk to the UK from the impact of climate change. First report was required to be made within 3 years, and then thereafter there's a 5-year time period aligned with the time period for carbon budgets. Each risk assessment must then be followed by the publication of a government programme of adaptation measures, with the most recent report being in 2017. Under section 58, the Secretary of State is under a duty to lay programmes before Parliament setting out the objectives of the government in relation to adaptation for climate change, the government's proposals and policies for meeting those objectives, and the timescales for introducing those proposals and policies addressing the risks that were identified in the Section 56 report. Those objectives, proposals and policies must contribute to sustainable development. Under Section 59, when the Climate Change Committee produces its report on progress towards meeting carbon budgets for the purposes of Section 36, it must also assess the progress made towards implementing the objectives, proposals and policies which are set out into the programmes laid before Parliament under Section 58. The Secretary of State published the most recent National Adaptation Plan in July 2018, which I'll come on to in a moment. The Secretary of State can also require public bodies and infrastructure operators that provide key services, which are referred to in the Act as reporting authorities, to report on what actions they are taking to address climate change impacts. The power is contained under Section 62 to direct the reporting authority to prepare a report that must contain an assessment of the current and predicted impact of climate change in relation to that authority's functions, a statement of the authority's proposals and policies for adapting to climate change in the exercise of its functions and the timescale for introducing those proposals and policies, and an assessment of the progress made by the authority towards implementing the proposals and policies which are set out in any previous reports. And the Secretary of State can also issue guidance under Section 61 in respect of those issues. Now, notably, under Section 63, it is an obligation on the reporting authority to comply with the directions issued by the Secretary of State, and a failure to comply with the statutory duty would be an illegality challengeable by way of judicial review. Interestingly, in the 2018 NAP, it is explained that the Secretary of State does not intend to direct organisations to report using his Section 62 power. The government's considered that a voluntary reporting process instead was the most constructive and collaborative approach for engaging reporting organisations, and it considered would allow the greatest flexibility and innovation to address climate risk. As such, the obligatory process prescribed by Section 62 and 63 is currently, and has been in the recent past, dormant. The National Adaptation Plan, published in July 2018, is the second since the 2008 Act was brought into force. It identifies six priority areas for climate change risk for the UK, which are set out on the slide. Notably, Annex 2 to the NAP is a detailed actions log, which sets out proposed planning or monitoring tasks. And I've just picked out a few examples from that annex to illustrate the approach. So, for example, the top two examples: in respect of restoring degraded ecosystems, the action is to develop and start to implement a nature recovery network, and then with regard to increasing and improving management of the seas, the obligation is to introduce a sustainable fisheries policy following Brexit. So an overarching theme of the detailed actions log is that it's relatively light in the main on concrete actions, or is vague in describing exactly what action is required. For example, the third instance down on the slide, one of the other key actions is to take action to eradicate high priority invasive non-native species. And one can understand such actions being criticized as excessively vague. However, there are, albeit perhaps in the minority, some clear tasks, such as planting 5,000 to 10,000 hectares of new woodland, up to 38,000 hectares by 2023 in England. So it should also be pointed out that overall, the detailed action log does show that there is significant work being undertaken. It doesn't seem to diminish that. When the NAP was published, it was criticised as being a partial plan and that it was hard to say the NAP was sustainable and effective. On a more positive note, an author of an Insight article published by the Climate Change Committee observed that it's worth comparing forwards to the first NAP by a certain Owen Paterson MP and the second by Lord Gardner, and noted that the difference in tone is quite striking, not just because the word climate is actually mentioned more than once in the latest version, that in of itself was certainly cause for optimism. The Climate Change Committee also has a duty to assess the progress in implementing the NAP, reporting to Parliament every 2 years. The most recent report was published on the 24th of June, 2021. In short, whilst the CCC recognised that there were some areas of progress, it noted that overall that progress had only been made in respect of a minority of sectors. The overarching theme of its report was that more effort is required. It made a series of recommendations, among which was that the Secretary of State should resume using his mandatory reporting power to reporting authorities under Section 62 of the Climate Change Act. The government recently published its response to the CCC's report, and it explained that it will consider those recommendations in its preparations for the next National Adaptation Programme and will consult on the use of the reporting power in future. So there is a possibility that we may see a shift back to that mandatory approach. In the last couple of years, there have also been a number of more targeted and discrete disparate planning measures for adaptation. And just to take a few very brief illustrative examples, in the Agriculture Act 2020, Section 19 now imposes a duty on the government to publish a regular report on the subject of food security. The Fisheries Act 2020 sets a new regime for fisheries management. The fisheries objective listed at Section 1 notably includes a sustainability objective, which requires that fish and aquaculture activities are sustainably, environmentally sustainable in the long term. And there's a specific reference to the precautionary principle. And then the Environment Act 2021 also includes a number of measures which are aimed at adaptation planning, including, for example, drought plans. So in summary, I think it's great credit that the Climate Change Act 2008 did establish a statutory framework for the purposes of planning and programming adaptation to climate change. It ensures, at the very least, that adaptation is kept on the government of the day's agenda, and I think the value of that is easy to underestimate. I think the complexity of the task of identifying and implementing clear and effective adaptation measures is also easy to underestimate. But that said, the primary function of the current legislative framework, it arguably is to plan to plan, which takes us to Glasgow. At COP26, securing action on adaptation was a key goal. The Glasgow Adaptation Imperative was produced to set out action to date and prescribe progress required to COP27, setting key objectives, which are again relatively broad. And there's a graphic representation of the imperative on the slide. So what was achieved? With the intention of strengthening action on adaptation, a two-year Glasgow Sharm el-Sheikh work programme on the global goal of adaptation, or the GLAS, was agreed as a product of the COP26 negotiations, and the GLAS objectives are set out on the slide. Whether this will be as significant a step forward as it says it intends to be will have to be seen in Egypt. But I think there'd be no question that the time for planning is running out and implementation is now imperative. Thank you. I'm now going to hand over to Steph.
Thank you, Gavin. As I'm sure many of our listeners are aware, the fourth key objective for COP26 was to deliver. That is to deliver on climate goals and to finalise the Paris rulebook, which are namely the guidelines for implementing the Paris Agreement. My presentation is divided into three parts. First, I'm going to start with the model of delivery. So how the Paris Agreement envisages that its long-term goal of limiting global warming will be achieved. Then I'm going to address progress from Paris to Glasgow, focusing in particular on the issue of international cooperation. I'm then going to consider what Glasgow failed to achieve and therefore needs to be the focus moving forward to COP27, which in my view is the pivotal issue of loss and damage. So then in terms of the model of delivery, the listeners will be aware that the principal long-term goal of the Paris Agreement is to limit global warming to 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, ideally 1.5 degrees. Each party is to undertake ambitious efforts as part of their nationally determined contributions to the global response to climate change. And the whole model, which is encapsulated here in this diagram, is based upon a continuous improvement cycle of planning, implementation, and review. And the rulebook provides specific guidance on each stage of that cycle. So in relation to planning, the rulebook addresses how countries should prepare their NDCs, including the information that should be presented so that other countries and stakeholders can understand how each country intends to account for its greenhouse gas emissions. In terms of the second stage, implementation, the model of delivery is premised on each country choosing how to implement the NDCs, but the necessary element of that is the country's report on their climate actions. The outstanding issue for Glasgow in respect of the rulebook on this particular stage was voluntary cooperation to reduce emissions in the form of the carbon markets, which I'll return to. And the third stage is review. Two levels of review. The first is at the country level, so that the progress of individual countries can be assessed against their target. And the second is the global level in the form of the global stocktake, which assesses progress to the overall goal within the agreement. As Stephen explained at the start of this afternoon's sessions, one of the key achievements of Glasgow is in respect of settling the rules on tradable emissions reductions units. But first, what exactly is Article 6? Article 6 contains three separate mechanisms for voluntary cooperation. Two are market-based and one is non-market, with the main objective of raising ambition. Mechanism one is set out in Article 6.2. The extract is provided on the slide. It's concerned with internationally transferred mitigation outcomes. It's essentially a bilateral arrangement between a country that has beaten its climate pledge based on the intended nationally developed contribution and can sell that overachievement to another country. So it could be emissions cuts, renewable energy capacity, or for example, forest expansion. The second mechanism is set out in Article 6.4. And this is essentially the international carbon market, otherwise known as the Sustainable Development Mechanism. This allows for trading of emissions reductions anywhere in the world by the public or private sector. And then finally, the third mechanism is set out in Article 6.8. This is the non-market approach to cooperation. That's not a defined term within the Paris Agreement, but it's essentially geared towards development aid. So the next question is why this issue was not resolved at COP25 in Madrid. I mean, it has been a controversial issue because on the one hand, there are those who consider the mechanism significantly raise climate ambition or lower costs. But on the other, many groups and individuals think there's a risk of fatally undermining the ambition of the Paris Agreement, particularly the risk of double counting. Glasgow therefore made significant progress in actually bottoming out the rules applicable to these mechanisms. And I've detailed there the kind of key outcomes in respect of what was agreed. The first one is the carrying over of carbon credits generated under the Kyoto Protocol since 2013, which would equate to about 320 metric tons of carbon dioxide equivalent. Importantly, the agreement, the final agreement, restricted the carryover of those carbon credits. The second is in respect of share of proceeds. So this only applies to Article 6.4, namely the International Carbon Market Mechanism. The negotiators agreed on a fixed tariff of 5% of all the emissions reductions created under Article 6.4. it doesn't apply to Article 6.2, but in relation to credits shared under that mechanism, the proposal was that they would make donations to the Adaptation Fund. Then in terms of double counting, the point there was ensuring corresponding adjustments, because there was a real concern that both the country selling and buying the carbon credits would account for it in their goals. And the way it's been accounted for is the country hosting an emissions reduction project will decide if the reductions will be counted towards its own target or sold elsewhere for other purposes. And the country must notify the UN supervisory body accordingly, so that they could keep track on any double counting. Finally, credits generated historically under the RED REDD plus scheme relating to deforestation have been excluded because these emission savings have been overstated. Moving then to the third part of my talk. So thinking forward now from Glasgow to Sharm el-Sheikh, my view is the key issue going forward is loss and damage. And I think it's encapsulated rather poignantly by the Kenyan Environment Minister quoted there. He said, in Kenya and Africa, we cry, we bleed. We bleed when it rains, we cry when it doesn't rain. So for us, ambition 1.5 is not a statistic. It is a matter of life and death. And in response to the negotiating bloc constituted of the US and the European Union, and I'll come to it in due course, but their position is essentially that this pillar of international climate policy can be addressed by way of technical assistance. He said as follows, giving money to consultants to fly around the globe and teach us about what loss and damage is does not address the actual loss and damage incurred by many communities around the world. So loss and damage is essentially the unavoidable impacts of climate change that cannot be adapted to from flooded villages or drought-struck farms. The way it's been dealt with historically is within the Warsaw International Mechanism from 2013, and that was also encapsulated in the Paris Agreement in Article 8. The principal function of that mechanism is to focus on research, dialogue, enhancing action. It doesn't do what G77 and China were looking for, namely providing a funding facility, which would ensure that vulnerable nations can actually respond through the damage to the damage inflicted by an overheating climate. What that bloc were ultimately seeking in the Glasgow negotiations was the operationalization of the Santiago network, principally in supporting them in accessing finance for loss and damage. That begs the question as to why loss and damage is so contentious. I mean, ultimately, it turns upon the issue of historical responsibility for causing climate change, and developed nations have consistently refused to accept liability or calls for compensation. So in terms of the Glasgow Climate Pact, it did not go as far as the G77 and China bloc wanted it to go. It failed to set up a loss and damage facility, as Stephen mentioned at the start of this afternoon session. It does address operationalizing the Santiago network, but the wording is weak and it does not specifically address the request for support in accessing fund. As you'll see from the wording there, the principal focus is on technical assistance. So that concludes my talk. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, here I am back again. Thank you to all the speakers for your presentations. Very well done. Plenty of food for thought there. I don't know whether we may possibly be joined on the panel by Nigel Pleming, QC. I don't know whether Nigel Pleming has arrived. Hello, Nigel.
Hi.
Nigel's back from, I gather, from COP26 and has also been taking challenges to Heathrow Airport since the days of the Wright brothers, so knows quite a bit about the topic. We've had one or two questions that have come in. I was going to start off actually with the first presentations by Catherine and Richard and bring Nigel into this. And I think essentially there are three questions really, if you want to make a note of them, decide how you want to deal with them. One is, well, in view, Richard, of all the problems you've highlighted, when actually is an action under the when might a Climate Change Act case actually succeed? Are there any wonderful cases where the stars would be aligned to allow that? Secondly, one of our listeners, viewers, has made a couple of points. One, I think, if I paraphrase it, is really, well, if you take the Maurice Kay quote that Richard gave, aren't the courts really living in the past here? They're inhabiting a world of deference, which really isn't justified in the light of the statutory provisions that we have, where the government has actually committed to these things. Second to that question, isn't the problem also that if one's simply looking retrospectively at what you do about a breach, failure to achieve the targets, then the damage has been done. The carbon dioxide has been emitted. Nobody can get it back. While you're thinking about that for a minute or so, I have been following, I don't know whether anyone else has, the comings and goings in Delhi in the Supreme Court of India in relation to the dreadful air pollution that's going on there at the moment. And the courts don't seem to have any problem whatsoever in India in taking an interventionist approach. The newspaper article I'm looking at on screen says that the Chief Justice of India told the advocate appearing for the Delhi government, pollution levels have to come down immediately. That's the main concern. How you do it is your problem. And effectively come back in a few days and tell us your urgent plan. If you don't come up with a complete proposal, then don't blame us for giving you directions as to how you do it. There does seem to be a slightly more robust approach in that jurisdiction. And I'm wondering why we don't have a similarly robust approach in the UK. Is it simply just the sorts of judges we have or what? So anyway, those I'll leave it to the three of you as to how you divide that up. But I think that would make a good set of questions to discuss.
Okay, shall I have a go and then
sure.
Anyone else come in? So the question of when the stars are aligned, we've been focusing on net zero in the courts. And I mentioned that after Heathrow and the Court of Appeal, there were lots of ramifications in inquiries, particularly infrastructure inquiries. And actually, Gethin and I were involved in one over at Manston, which was the first DCO to be quashed. And the panel, the examining authority in Manston, did make findings as a result of Section 1 of the Climate Change Act that the contribution that Manston would make to emissions would place at peril the ability to meet the 2050 target, the revised target of net zero. That's quite a rare event. And I think the problem is, the person who's asked the question is right to point out that the Maurice Kay quote, the Lord Justice Maurice Kay quote, does suggest a sort of judicial harking back to the past. It's not an excuse for failing to grapple with the provisions of acts when they are before you. But I think the real problem is, referring back to Catherine's presentation, is this combination in Section 1 of the duty to ensure, which looks very positive, but then that duty is to ensure something by 2050. And that is quite a long way away. And it's quite easy for the Secretary of State to say that there's a lot of progress that will be made in a decade's time. And that is an argument that is made time and again. It is very difficult on the basis of the current wording of either Section 1 or 4, I think, to hang a successful challenge. I don't think it's permissible. Of course, Maurice Kay was talking about this change in a different context, in the context of the Warm Homes and Energy Conservation Act 2000, which provides that Section 2 less positive and less onerous duties than we meet in the Climate Change Act. But I do think on the current wording, it is particularly difficult to hang a successful net zero challenge. So the final comment I'd make in answer to Stephen's first question is when would the stars be aligned? I think it may require more legislation or legislative change that imposes both a real duty, but one that must be discharged imminently, or that there must be some check to ensure that the 2050 target is likely to be discharged in due course. I don't know if others have reflections on that.
Can I come in just because of the reference to Heathrow that Stephen mentioned? The judgment in the Supreme Court could be seen as disappointing in that the decision could have gone to the left or to the right, depending on the interpretation of the wording of government policy. And it could be said that that was an opportunity missed by the judiciary to do their bit to fight against climate change. When I was in Glasgow, one of the subjects that kept coming up was the Royal Dutch Shell case that has already been mentioned. Just two thoughts on that, and then the continuation of that case. The Royal Dutch Shell case is important in terms of domestic litigation as well as other countries, in that it combined two ideas. One, that there was a duty of care, an unwritten law in Netherlands terms, or as we would say, the common law, a duty of care owed by companies such as Shell to persons affected by its activities, melded to the combined effect of Articles 2 and 8 of the European Convention of Human Rights. And the argument was that in the absence of a right to a safe environment, those two articles can be fused together to create an effective substitute for the absence of that right. Combine it with the duty of care, and you get the makings of a successful claim. One of the problems with the Royal Dutch Shell case, which also had repercussions around the world, including Nigeria, is that there is now an appeal by the government, and in the Netherlands, an appeal is completely de novo. So they're starting from scratch with witnesses again, and that won't be heard for another 18 months, which itself is accelerated. It should have been 3 to 4 years is the normal timetable. So that's one case. But I went to what would be normally a tent, but a divided space in Glasgow for the European Investment Bank and the Benelux countries. I've got the program with me, and they had over 30 or 40 events in the first 4 days of COP26, just in that one space. And one of the events I went to, in fact, the best event I went to, was a number of lawyers from Italy, Spain, Ireland, South Korea, Germany, all involved in current litigation based around the same idea as Royal Dutch Shell, but in particular, a case which is being orchestrated from Galway City in Ireland is a case against 33 nations on behalf of a group of young persons, which is to be heard in the European Court of Human Rights in the next couple of years. And that does look really interesting. Whether that will be stars aligned or a different argument, but it may be successful in the UK, it may not. And then it will have to be a change of the judiciary or change of their attitude or legislation. Anybody else?
Sanctions. Just on the I think it was the third point about the legislation being backward looking when in the context of irreversible harm to the environment, we should be really forward looking. That is a problem, I think, with sections 1 and 4. And that's bound up with the long timescales that those obligations relate to. So one option, Richard's mentioned this again, is reform to the legislation to introduce shorter interim timescales so that there can be intervention before the pass has been sold. The second possibility, I mentioned it with little optimism, but then Richard's reference to and the Manston case suggests there may be some scope for this type of argument, is to identify policies or decisions, perhaps relating to infrastructure, which can be shown to be inconsistent with the achievement of either carbon budgets or net zero targets. The other thing to look at is the plans that the government has to introduce to demonstrate how carbon budgets will be achieved and how carbon budgets put us on a pathway to net zero. And that is perhaps a line of inquiry that could lead to a court challenge. So that those are, which would be forward looking rather than waiting until we reached exceeded a budget or are on a pathway where net zero is not going to be possible.
Could I just mention two other points? One, Stephen, you mentioned what's happening in Delhi. In Pakistan, there's a similar approach by the Supreme Court, the senior judge, who has ordered I think it's the state there rather than a company, that there should be continuing reporting back to the court as to progress made in keeping to their net zero promise or whatever the promise is. The other one on Heathrow is that there may be challenges, if not now, along the road on under Section 6 of the Planning Act, which is on the basis that there's been a change of circumstances as the requirements of climate change mitigation and how aviation fits into the impact on our climate. And that may be a space to watch over the next few months and even years.
Okay, thank you, Nigel, and thank all of you. Now, I've got something that follows on from what we were discussing, which is the case against Shell. Question really for Ruth. Is there any sort of synergy between what you've described in terms of the enhanced reporting requirements and that sort of litigation? In other words, does the obligation to report make such litigation or successful arguments in such litigation more likely?
Yeah, thanks, Stephen. So looking at the cases and certainly looking at why many of these cases have failed and, you know, a very small handful have been successful, two of the big differences to me, stepping back and looking at them, one of them seems to be, of course, the difficulty we have in this kind of litigation of establishing a duty that someone owes either to shareholders or citizens or various different parties. But that's a real difficulty, particularly in these kind of private litigation cases that people are bringing. And I think these new reporting requirements make that perhaps, you know, it's not going to be the silver bullet, but we're moving in a direction of putting more of these explicit duties on companies in a way that it's been difficult to formulate them before. I think the second point, and it relates to something that Catherine has said as well, is that, you know, in the Shell case, we do have the court going through in quite granular detail, both the evidence or the information that Shell has put out, but also looking through its whole entire corporate structure and seeing whether it's really going to stand up to that kind of messaging. Now, where I see this reporting making perhaps some of those cases slightly easier is that before there's this real disconnect between, on the one hand, having to trust public statements, but actually, unless you're going to spend a lot of money or if you have a huge amount of expertise, being able to look into the granular detail of that evidence and see if there's a case in there. And I think the direction that we're moving in terms of these reporting obligations, you know, again, it's not going to be the silver bullet, but what it does mean is it makes it, one, a little bit clearer the kind of duties have. And I think that's particularly interesting for shareholder disputes that people sometimes try bring. And the second point is now having some kind of evidence that people can look through and say, well, look, this is the statement of what you've said your objectives are or your targets. But when we actually look at how you're going to achieve that, we see actually the report that you've provided is a lot shorter. So I see some hope there. Again, I think we're a little bit further away from being able to have these, you know, strong cases, but we're certainly moving in the right direction in terms of firming up these duties and then having the kind of evidence one would need to support a case.
Okay, thank you very much, Ruth. Now, just a couple of things, I think, for Steph, if we can go back to Steph. You're a little bit squeezed on time on your discussion of loss and damage at the end. Maybe you'd just like to explain to us really why that aspect, loss and damage, is such an important part of international climate change policy, and also to deal with one of the questions that's come from one of our viewers, which is that given that the polluter pays principle is pretty universally accepted in international law, how viable is it that developed countries can continue to dodge payback obligations to the global south or developing countries? And the person says they would expect the Marshall Islands to be taking a case before too long, question mark. You may not know about the Marshall Islands, but perhaps you could deal with that, Steph.
Thank you very much, Stephen. I agree that loss and damage is an incredibly important pillar of international climate policy alongside mitigation and adaptation. It is a very fraught issue because ultimately it raises questions regarding liability and compensation. In terms of the specific question regarding the polluter pays principle, I've got two main observations. The first one is that yes, it is an established principle, but how exactly does it apply in the context of historical responsibility for greenhouse gas emissions? Because essentially we're looking at previous generations within certain developed nations that are responsible for industrialization and the use of fossil fuels. So I certainly take on board the fact that the polluter pays principle is a very powerful tool that should be used in the context of potential mitigation, but it's not necessarily so straightforward in the context of historic responsibility. The second point is in respect of how this all plays into climate justice and the responsibility shared globally, whether that's justice in terms of corrective justice or distributed justice. But certainly I think there is a role for the courts. Obviously that is extremely difficult in the international sphere, but if we look at domestic examples in the law of tort, ultimately if you commit a wrong and that wrong causes loss and damage to a third party, then you are liable. So there's certainly strong arguments, but obviously it's significantly more difficult in the international sphere. And yes, I did hear that, I think it's Tuvalu, Antigua and Barbuda that have suggested they will be bringing legal proceedings against the biggest emitters.
Okay, so that's another one to keep an eye on. Thank you all. I think you've dealt with all of the questions that we had. I'm going to wrap up in a moment, but I just wanted to give Nigel the opportunity, a couple of minutes, just as you've been in person at COP26, give us what were your impressions? I mean, were you in a constant whiskey-induced haze, or did you take anything away from it?
No, it was a constant whiskey-induced haze, and I was horrified. This is the first time I've bought a whiskey in a bar for years. I was horrified that the size of a tot in Scotland is no more generous than a tot in England. So that was quite a disappointing moment. But let me just be serious for a moment, because I was there representing BICL, the British Institute of International Comparative Law. So it was a law-based trip, and BICL was co-funding or hosting an event at Glasgow University. So it was an off-site event, mobilising the rule of law in climate change. When we got into the blue zone, there was a kind of chaos, in that there were so many events going on, so many events in different places at the same time, that it was really difficult to find the right place to spend your time. And the facilities themselves were a bit stressed, even from the beginning. However, to be in one of the big rooms when the big beasts are speaking, such as John Kerry, of what was really a privilege. He was excellent. A couple of events also in the big rooms were really disappointing. They were typical hot air, nothing really said. Climate change is a serious problem. We've got to do something about it. What about the young? But then you listen to that for half an hour and drift off, hoping their whiskey would turn up. And then suddenly somebody would say something really insightful and important from an unexpected quarter, particularly on reparation. And one issue that was being developed away from the meetings when we were talking just socially, was if there's more and more focus on reparation and the amount of money that will require, the role of insurers, for example, how will they fit into the scheme of things? If the bill for living with climate change is so huge, that will help to persuade countries to compel the major emitters to stop, because otherwise that bill will be crippling to the developed countries. So I thought that was an interesting theme. I left after 4 or 5 days, and wish I'd stayed longer, because I was beginning to get into the swing of it. And as I said, it was a privilege to be there. I hope to be in Egypt, where the swimming might be better in next year.
Well, thank you, Nigel. Certainly one of those landmark events, isn't it? So I think we should probably wrap up there. Thank you to our speakers and to our guest, Nigel, for all of that. I just say that if you do have any further questions or thoughts that occur to you, you can contact us. You can contact Charlie or Beth in our marketing department. They'll pass through any questions or observations that you have. And do please use our Chamber's website. That has a wealth of information on all sorts of topics, but including climate change. We have an energy law blog now. We have a newsletter that has regular articles on these sort of topics. And one final plug for something you can also access through the Chamber's website, and that is this publication from Queen Mary University of London, the Centre for Energy Law and the Centre for Climate Change Law and Studies, which I'm a visiting academic with, have recently produced a review on energy and climate change. Many of the same topics that we've been discussing this afternoon, including actions by children and young people, insurance and finance. You can get that, a hard copy of it, from Queen Mary, but you can also get it PDF via our Chamber's website. That's well worth having a look at, I think. But anyway, I think that's all for this afternoon. Thank you for joining us. Hope you've stayed through to the end. Wish you a good rest of the day and rest of the week. And I hope we'll see you again at some future events. So thank you all, and thank you again to our panel. Goodbye.